figured it out. I figured it out from black and white.
There are many wonderful things I can say about this community, especially since I have many family that are still here. My father was born here in Peabody, and I have a number of relatives that are surrounding me right now, so I'm a little anxious because I don't think I've ever spoken in front of some of them, so this is a little bit of a treat for me. That title tends to be a little bit controversial in some people's minds, thinking, what do you mean? How can addiction and spirituality have anything to do with one another? But as Orthodox Christians, they have everything to do with one another. And so what I hope to do tonight is share some basic thoughts. My prayer is most of my thoughts will make sense to you. If they don't make sense, we'll have time for some discussion, and so I can clarify some of my thoughts. That's the first thing. The second thing is I plan to do this with three ideas in mind. The first is to give you an introduction to addiction from an Orthodox Christian spiritual perspective, because I don't think you're going to get it from too many places besides people affiliated with the theological school. So I owe that to you, number one. Number two, God willing, as we continue in our conversations, I'm hoping we also get a better appreciation about the eleos of God. Does that word sound familiar to you? Eleos. Mercy, bravo, mercy or compassion. Eleos, we say it a lot in church all the time when we say, Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy. The eleos comes from that Greek word, which in English we translate as mercy or compassion. And so I'd like to touch in our conversations or in our hearts aspects of the discussion of spirituality and addiction on the eleos of God. And a topic that's new for me again, the topic of empathy. Why is empathy important for Christians and for human persons in general? All right? So the more I think of that this is going to be like a two-hour class, so I think I'll try to cut this down about 15 or 20 minutes. So I'm going to do a lot of skipping, but to try to introduce the essence of these issues so that we can talk about it. Okay, so the first thing I'd like to say is everything we do as Orthodox Christians, everything that we believe, is based on authentic relationship. So what do I mean by authentic relationship? We can use another word for authentic. We can use the word genuine. We can use the word real. We can use the word true. True relationship, genuine relationship, authentic. I like using authentic because in Greek, the word for authentic is pretty much the same thing, authentikos, authendia. But in the ancient Greek understanding of the word and into early Christian understanding of the word, authendia also points to authority. All right? So isn't it interesting? That which is most true to itself, in other words, how it's created to be, has its most authority just by being its most true self. Now, what does that mean? Does being authentic mean I can tell you how I feel because I feel it? No. Does authentic mean I can just say anything that comes to mind or act any way I want just because I get the impulse? Absolutely not. Well, there are a lot of people in our society that do think being authentic means just acting on impulse. That's not what I'm talking about, all right? I think all of you understand what I'm saying. No one's complaining. That's good. So far, so good. And so when we talk about authentic relationship, we're talking about our being and responding in a way that's most true to how we are created to be, one, and number two, how we do that in the presence of God in the moment, in the simeron, in the right now, in the today. Why is this important? Well, because we are all created in the image and likeness of God. What does that mean? Well, if we're created in the image and likeness of God, and the church has a lot to say about that, and Father Anthony and Father Chris, I'm sure, talk about this with you as your pastors, also calls our attention to being created to a God that's three in one, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe that God is three persons. What's strange about that is it's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One and one and one equals one. So we believe in the three-in-one God, where one and one and one equals one. This is an ancient math equation that goes back to the 3rd and 4th centuries that St. Basil used, that St. Gregory of Nyssa used, that the leaders in the early church used to explain to non-believers why we weren't polytheists, right? That we believe in a God that was three in one, one and one and one equals one. Why is this important? Because if God is in relationship with himself, that the Father, Son, and Spirit are irreducible to each other, and we are created in that image and likeness, and they are in communion with each other. They are in love with one another in ways that we can't describe. And there are many books on this, and as much we can say, and if you want to discuss this later, we can do that. We are called, lo and behold, to that same level of communion on a creaturely level. As creatures, God calls us. God can't wait to have that kind of communion with us. So when I say authentic relationship, we are called to relate with God authentically and one another authentically. And so that is the foundation upon which we believe as Christians regarding our vocation as humans. Okay, so that's the first thing. Second thing, because of that, what is reality? On planet Kyriaki, who tries to give you the best synopsis possible, reality from our perspective as Orthodox Christians is our abiding in the love of the presence of the triune God thrice holy. So that's reality. All the people, all creation, all the angels, all of us being in the presence of God, even now, this side of the grave. Now, why aren't we seeing the angels? Why aren't we all kind of being our best selves? Why do we see all this? Well, we all know sin entered the world. We know disease entered the world because of Adam and Eve's sin. And limitation, sickness, death, and sin is with us. And Christ has come in the world to overcome that. And so why do I give you this very quick overview of important aspects of what we believe as Christians? Because all of this has everything to do with addiction, right? So if growing in authentic relationship is part of what it means to be growing in a healthy way with others, God, and one another, and creation, both spiritually and physically, then when we are sick, there is something inauthentic going on. Okay? Something inauthentic is going on. And so put that idea of inauthentic relationship on the side right now. And now we're going to open another topic, and we'll come back to this in a minute. This has everything to do with addiction. Even contemporary 21st century North America, our understanding as scientists and clinicians has deepened profoundly in the past 15 or 20 years regarding what addiction is. In some ways, nudging closer to what we as Orthodox are saying, but of course not close enough, but in ways that as an Orthodox, I'm very happy. Let me ask you, just for a minute, what do you think an addiction is? Dependency. Dependency on what? Anything. Chemicals. Dependence on everything. Something that changes your personality, absolutely. Anybody else? Very good. What else comes to mind when you think about addiction? Habit, very good. What kinds of things come to mind for addiction? Drugs, sweets, alcohol. Very good. Gambling, what else? Exercise, very good. What else? Church, very good. There is such a thing as spiritual addiction, folks. An addiction from an Orthodox perspective is something out of whack, something out of balance for how we are created to be. Right? It is how we, if we are called to be in authentic relationship with God, one another, and creation, then we have some kind of imbalanced relationship with something on the created order, that we are putting it in a divine place. We are giving it more importance than we should. And so when it becomes an addiction, what happens is it tries, it becomes like a god, small g, in our life. When we talk about addiction from an Orthodox perspective, and I start talking about this at the seminary with my students, I've been teaching the class for the past 10 years. I can guarantee you almost all the students that come, bless them, because it's an elective, they don't have to take the class. They come in with an attitude of, gee, I'm going to become a priest, or I'm going to serve the church as a counselor, as a teacher, and I'm going to want to know what addictions are about, because I know some of those people are going to be in my parish. I know some of those people are going to be in my class, or some of those people are going to be in my presence, in my ministry. And so some of those people, that kind of an attitude is like an us versus them way of thinking. Do you all follow me?
Yes.
Like us meaning I'm the student and I'm going to come in to try to help those poor people who are sick and addicted. I know I'm doing my job if someplace between week 2 and 4, the students start shaking their head and they're saying, oh, I have a problem too. Right? Oh. Why? Because an addiction for us, as I started to say, is something out of balance, something that takes us away from an authentic relationship, an authentic growing relationship with the triune God and one another, both physically and spiritually. When the students start realizing, I have an issue too, even though they're not abusing alcohol, even though they're not abusing sex or drugs or rock and roll or even religion. I mean, I think the list. One of my students this year came to class with extra credit. Presidenta, I have an extra credit project here I did for you in the class. Okay, what is it, Sergeant? I counted 146 addictions. And he started. Excitement. You can be addicted to excitement. You can be addicted to exercise. You can be addicted to, he didn't realize that one of our readings the following week was going to cover that same thing. It was a revelation for him to start seeing ways we can be out of balance, ways we can be out of order with our relationship with God, one another, and creation in everyday life. So, what does that mean? Those of you who have studied Orthodox spirituality, this is sounding a little bit close to our understanding about the passions, right? How many of you have heard about the passions? Okay, very good. The passions, one of the ways the fathers in the church talk about the passions are imbalanced attachments to what might often be something benign or even good that put itself out of in wrong priority when God should be the priority. So what all addictions want to be is God. And so in the class, we wind up expanding the understanding of addiction because I think this is how the church looks at it. When we talk about the passions, we're talking about an imbalanced relationship with something that wants to be God when God should be God. And so one of the words we started to use in the class, which I think is more correct to refer to the addiction, is to refer to all addictions and things leading to addictions as an attachment. So when we say that we have an attachment, oftentimes it's invisible. And why is that? From our perspective, the only state of health is when the person is in communion with God. God created us to be in communion with Him. We use many words to describe this. Engodded is one old word for that. Theosis we often use as divinization, deification. And so when we're not in that place, then we are always vulnerable to everything else. One of the images I like to learn, I like to use, is to think of health in terms of like a healthy cell before it becomes a cancerous tumor. We're all infected, so to speak, by the fall. We're all infected, so to speak, by the illness of what it means to easily get knocked off our perch in the church, so to speak, by distractions that would be God, because that's life. It marks a change in how we engage one another. And all of a sudden, one of the changes that happens is that there seems to be a kind of palpable compassion, palpable pastoral, like everybody kind of like lets out a breath. Like, oh, okay. And we all, like the walking wounded, talk more about the disease that affects all of us human beings. But it takes many forms. It can take the form of addiction to alcohol. It can take the form of addiction to drugs, dependence on drugs, dependence on eating, dependence on people. We can be addicted to people pleasing. I have that little tendency. Hello, people pleasing. What? Well, of course I love to teach. I love to do counseling. Of course I love to be with people. But they can't become my God. I depend on people a little bit more than I should, because I should be depending on God. Now, those of you who are my relatives and who remember me being 100 pounds thinner for most of my adult life, did I say thinner? Heavier than I am most of my adult life. Also know I might have had a problem with my own health issues regarding eating. And so what is interesting is when those relationships start getting healthier, like I was no longer out of balance, then other things, because the fall of Adam and Eve is still affecting all of us, it wants to go other places. So maybe when people start addressing one of their issues that has been out of balance, I can promise you it, the addiction, energy, or the disease, as what they like to say in Alcoholics Anonymous, likes to go someplace else. And so from an Orthodox perspective, this is very humbling and yet very liberating, because it's not drug, but it's a relationship with, and it's a relationship with one other person and with God about how I need to go forward in a my relationship with that other, that substance, that activity, in a way that's healthy and more life-giving for me. I've learned a lot in a backwards way about Orthodoxy, even though I'll leave it at that. I went to seminary first, but I went 7 years of seminary and then learned more about Alcoholics Anonymous, then learned more about the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous and all the anonymous 12-step groups, where their foundation is how they were started, and most people don't know this, it's in their big book, their big blue book, was founded by the founder, Bill W., going to Oxford, connecting with people from the Oxford movement who were at that time Catholic, Orthodox, and Protestant theologians trying to bring Christians together, living by a credo of six principles. Hang on with me. Those six principles, Bill W., who started AA, realized, saw all these domains, the physical, spiritual, psychological, relational, cognitive, all in these six principles, but teased them out and turned them into 12. So the 12 steps of AA come from the six credo principles of the Oxford movement, which came right out of the early church, came right out of the early fathers. So that's why, as an Orthodox, someone trained in theology, I can still in the 12 steps. And so, so what the fathers talk about and what the 12-step community does in a very concrete way is we have something disordered, we have to first admit that we're powerless over it. So there's that inner wakefulness and honesty of saying, I'm powerless over this issue, addiction, relationship. The second step is to admit that there is a power greater than me. Up until recently, AA and all the 12-step groups would say, this is God. Now they're a little bit more interfaith, and they'll say God or higher power. But it's not, as Orthodox Christians, we would say God. Okay, and so that we like old AA. And so that God is able to take anything that we have no power over and can take care of that. And the third step is to turn our will over to this God. And then this, you know, the 4 through 12 are concrete steps on how to do that. Step 4 is to take a fearless moral inventory. Where have I blown it? How have I hurt myself and others?
regarding this. So this is very courageous work in order to get clean with ourselves in the presence of God. Now, doesn't this sound wonderful as an Orthodox Christian and in the addiction world? You can see why I get so excited. I'm joking a bit, but I really am so grateful to this program that, in a sense, bears witness to the life of the church and to the spirituality of the church and the resources of the church. But in some ways, we rediscover the church by seeing its simplified in the 12th century. So, to continue on, what this also implies, we have to be in relationship with other people trying to address this. So there's ways of we have a brotherhood and sisterhood with others to help support us as we humbly keep surrendering our issue to God in the presence of others who get it and who protect our confidence. And then to work on it a day at a time in conjunction with friendships of others who have been doing this, hopefully some longer than we have, to give us some guidance. And so if this is what's happening in the 12-step world with Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous, Sex and Love Addicts Anonymous, Food Addicts Anonymous, Spending Anonymous, Debtors Anonymous, name some more. I mean, there's so many 12-step groups, thank you, God. How much more does that apply for the resources in our own church? The good news is sometimes, God knew from before the establishment of creation all my problems that I was going to have. He knew all the problems you all were supposed to have. And that none of our issues, none of our problems are so big that God can't help us overcome them and heal us. How is that going to happen? I don't know. Why? Because we're all unique. And the way God heals, if you read the Bible, if you read the lives of the saints, when Father Anthony and I were talking about this in the car a little bit tonight, that if you read the resources of the church carefully, nobody is healed the exact same way, right? Some people are healed from blindness or from being dead, deafness, or from being lame, or what have you, by the Lord, or through the centuries, the Lord heals people through the life of the church. Each healing is tailor-made to the person reaching out to him. Why? Because we are all unique persons. Nobody is a repeat. Nobody is redundant. I mean, this is, God delights in all of us, and he wants full communion with all of us, and wants all of us to be in communion. Now, that's his doing more than ours, because of our own. But that this is what he's so excited about and so happy about making real for us as we show up, striving to. And I'll use an Orthodox word, purify our hearts, purify our minds, purify our intentions and our actions so that he can move more deeply in our own. The more we can trust God that we are in the center of the palm of his hand, and he knows how we're feeling, he knows how we're responding from the inside out, he just wants us to be trusting. When I say relaxed, I think the better word is trusting. In a trusting way, keeping sort of our radar in how we're doing. Now, still, we're all unique persons. Regarding alcohol, I've done a lot of work with people who have issues with alcohol. Some people can be addicted with just a few drinks as young men or women, and that's it. Other people can, drink a whole platoon of army guys under the table and be fine, and they're all passed out. Everybody really is different in how they are wired regarding, let's say, physical addiction to alcohol. But what is important is that honesty of keeping that trusting of God radar of trying to stay in that, the scriptures regarding stipulations for deacons and presbyters is that they be sober and temperate. And which means, and for deacons, they say specifically, not addicted to too much wine, which means you can have some wine, but not too much, not too much. And so trying to find that middle healthy way. But for all of this, what's middle is 3/4 of a glass of wine, otherwise I fall asleep, on the table. Other people can have a glass or two, and they're fine. And so regarding a chemical addiction. But this also applies to many other things. I am worried when I see this culture romanticizing spending, romanticizing alcohol, romanticizing sex, romanticizing materialism, consumerism. There's a romance about it. Now, romancing something is a step in grooming someone. A predator does that. Groom someone or something before they pounce. So I think we are being groomed by powers more subtle than I can point at to, you know, go shopping, go do this, go do that, think I can't do something when actually God's given me the ability to do this discerning without them. And so it's really important to be peacefully honest with ourselves, peacefully awake and aware, and talking it out with a few wise people we trust and love. How does this all affect children? We have to be responsible grown-ups when we're dealing with children. And if we're not responsible grown-ups and we're acting childish, having a tantrum because so-and-so got elected or so-and-so did not get elected, if we have a tantrum because I don't like, you know, the children see us acting out. If the children see us being disrespectful to one another, we are training them to react the same way a few years later. Absolutely. You can be addicted to anger. We can be, one of the, people can be oppressed. This is something I've been thinking a lot about. When people are oppressed, when people are enslaved, and there's lots of ways to be enslaved, the fathers of the church teach that free will reduces by, let's say, 50%. You still have free will, but it's harder to leave. That's why when someone was abused, be it an abused wife or even an abused man, depending on where he is, it's harder for them to leave because when they are truly oppressed, it's like half of their own soul becomes inactive. You know, they don't have that capacity of strength. And so the fathers of the church are very merciful to people who've been enslaved. They can't go on. And so getting back to children, if we're modeling bad behavior, number one. Number two, we are also not attending to them. We are not meeting them face to face, eye to eye, and listening to them and engaging them like real persons. They're little, our children are our persons, you know, they're littler, you know, littler than we are, but they're just as fully persons as us adults. And so when we miss those opportunities in their first years of their life to treat them as authentic persons, which means not like 20-year-olds when they're 2, all right? Not like 40-year-olds when they're 14, but honoring them as honestly as we know how and being completely honest with them at their level, they will wind up maybe surpassing us in maturity. And we'll need them when we're, you know, when they're mature, we're going to need them, you know. Our archdiocese has a wonderful department called the Department of Family Care, and the people there I love very much. Presbytera Melissa Tungranis, who's one of the people responsible for the work being done there, has a lot to say. All of us have strengths and weaknesses, and so I don't know if you're talking about personality style or character. Okay, personality style, you can be a leader and be an extrovert, or you can be a leader and not be an extrovert, be an introvert, but it will be different. It will be different. I think what matters is that we become the characters God is creating us to be, because that's what He wants us to be.
So they're more peaceful and they're closer to God.
We are more peaceful, closer to God, and then we are more at peace with each other, so I can listen to you better. I can hear you better. I don't have an agenda when I'm listening to you because I really want to get to know you for who you are because you're unrepeatable. We can be addicted to ourselves, right? Narcissism we can look at as a kind of addiction. You know, it's all about me. And so that imbalance. And so, you know, the church is very wise. The church says love of self, that's the narcissism. Oh, it's all about me. I'm wonderful. But love for self, that's really important. You know, take care of yourself. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. That means how, you know, that there has a kind of self-respect. There's a kind of philotimo is a Greek word that's dignity that's proper for each of us that we're called to have, so that we can encourage others to grow in theirs. And so there's healthy love for self, and there's unhealthy love of self. So that's like an addiction too. Anything that wants to be God, that's not God. What's the first sin? Adam and Eve, when they fell, it's the desire to be God without God. That's Orthodox dogmatics in a sentence on the issue. That the sin of pride is the result of Adam and Eve wanting to be God without God. That's why they ate from the fruit of knowledge of good and evil. Why? Because God had said, don't eat of that, eat of everything else but that. Why? Now this is something we don't really know often. We learn in seminary, but I'm not sure we talk about it out in with our people as often as we should. And that is because Adam and Eve were still relatively young in their adulthood. Right? They were naive. So it wasn't time. The Lord may have wanted them to have that fruit as well, but it wasn't time yet. They needed to grow in their, they were growing from one level of perfection to the next. And so so it was easy for the serpent, knowing they were naive, how to entice them away from God. And when you read the Genesis story, you see how the serpent enticed Eve and Adam fell with her. And so it's like he kind of like almost seduced her from stopping to love God and putting her attention on loving the fruit and what it could get her. You know, power, glory, and honor. The desire to be God without God. And so the flip side of the same coin is the desire for power. And so if you ask many of the top addiction specialists, especially those who are specialists regarding issues concerning relationship, so codependency, addictions to relationships, sexual addictions, all of those having to do with human relationships, they will say the first addiction is not alcohol, the first addiction is not drugs, the first addiction is not all these other behaviors. The first addiction is the addiction to power and control, which is basically what Adam and Eve did when their love for the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil came before their love of God. This is giving you a sense of how perverse, how easy it is to get imbalanced for all of us. Me first, and that's why I'm on. You know, we always have to keep checking. And sometimes when we blow it, it doesn't mean that it's kind of like God was, I should say, happy that we blew it, but are we going to learn the lesson that we need to learn when we blow it? Because we will blow it. We will make mistakes. And so, but are we learning, and are we growing as a result of that? Whenever we manipulate, intentionally strategize to try to get something, we're trying to get, it's like cheating in a relationship. We're trying to get something in a shortcut kind of way. I'm very anti-shortcut, me personally. I think there's ways of healing and growing that might be accelerated, but accelerated healing is not the same as cheating, you know? So I think just there's so many ways we can manipulate one another. It's because we want something, and we don't admit it to the other person. Sometimes we don't even admit it to our own selves. That's why the fearless moral inventory that we need to take every day, that the fathers talk about, is really important. You know, have I been true? Have I been loving? Have I been honest with others? Or have I been trying to control through manipulation? When I catch myself I was being dishonest with my own self about something. So then I was meant to be manipulating someone because I wasn't being honest with myself about this meant more to me than I realized. Well, when I hit the wall with that realization and I break my nose and I lose a friendship or something like that, that becomes that can become a moment of grace that lets me see what I've been covering up as a result of my own machinations. I would always talk to my spiritual father first about if I thought I had an addiction, But I would think most spiritual fathers, I can't answer for all of them, but the ones I know, that's the ones I know, would probably encourage, depending what the addiction is, counseling and AA or Al-Anon for the spouse or the friend of the addict, or NAA for the drug addict, because you need to be with other people speaking the same language, being really brutally honest with getting that disease dethroned. And the more Orthodox clergy learn about the inner creation of the 12-step movement, the more they'll see that the early church everywhere. And so I would think that there would be some kind of healthy collaboration going on. I can't answer for every priest. I can't answer for every meeting of 12-step. You know what I'm saying? It's unfair and abusive to the clergy or any specific person in the community to be your answer if you've got some kind of issue that needs help. But your parish priest, your spiritual father, can be the captain of the team. He can be the mother and father of helping you grow, but he can't be the whole family. You've got to go and find other ways. Because if it's real, it's going to happen in your life and in my life. Why? Because God doesn't create junk, number one. Number two, God does not make exceptions for his children. We are all his children, and we are all, nobody is redundant. So all of his love for each of us is complete and unconditional toward us, according to what we can bear and how we're responding. To move with courage, that the gospel is as true in the center of the parish where we worship as it is out in Route 1. The gospel is just as true there as it is in the middle of the nave of the church. Can you be addicted to anxiety? Yes and no. Anxiety sometimes happens because it happens. You know, it's also a physiological reaction to some types of stress. So even if we are not prone to an anxiety disorder, sometimes people might be prone for various reasons, there are certain stressors that can happen. When my dad died, when my father died, that's not one of my issues, but on his 40 days, we had the memorial service at the St. George Greek Orthodox Church in Hyannis, and we had the mercy meal. I left. My husband was in New Hampshire at our parish. I didn't go. I stayed with my family, and I was driving home, and my body started shaking, and my heart started like I thought I was going to have a heart attack, and I'm thinking, oh wait a minute, is this a heart attack? You know. Is this really a heart attack? You're heading toward the hospital anyway. Keep heading to the hospital. But I said, you just buried your father, and you're the eldest child, and you just sort of helped with the 40-day memorial service. And, you know, it could be that you're just realizing you've let your father go. And so, thankfully, as I was going toward the hospital, the other Orthodox church, St. Michael's Church, that I would also sometimes go to, in Katuit, happened to be like within a block, so I went to the church there because I knew the presidenta there was a nurse. So I happened to get there, they were having their coffee hour, they knew where I was, hug, hug, kiss, kiss. Presidenta, I told her the story, she got one of the other parishioners who was also a nurse, and I had two nurses on my arms, you know, one taking my pulse here, the other taking my pulse there, and they both, it was kind of funny, said, oh no, it's anxiety. You're not having a heart attack.
Can you be born anxious?
It's possible to be born anxious for lots of reasons that we don't have to talk about right now. But the good thing about anxiety is when we start realizing it, we start noticing it, it means we're starting to have a perspective to it. We can speak to it. When it's ruling, when our anxieties rule us, you know, we can't do anything. But once we're saying, oh, I'm anxious, by naming it, by identifying it, we are starting to have control over it. Now, we might not have total control over the anxiety, but we can ask God for help. Just like I said, okay, God, am I having a heart attack or is this an anxiety attack? I'll go to the church. The second I realized and I could name, identify what was going on, I went and got help. That's the first thing. The second thing is, it's really important to name it and get help. Why? Because we can become so familiar with the anxiety. It's called the sin of familiarity. The sin of familiarity. We usually have the sin of familiarity to people, but the sin of familiarity could also take place with issues. So I become, you know, oh, it's my anxiety again. And then I wallow in it. Oh, it's my depression again. And I wallow in it. Now, the second I notice my depression, that's a grace. The second I notice my anxiety, that's a grace. Why? The grace is I can identify it, I can name it. Then I can give it to God. As soon as we name it, it reduces its power by 50%. Why? Because up until then, we were like floundering in it 100%. The second we're saying, oh, it's my depression, or oh, it's my anxiety, it's still there, it still wants to hurt us, but it's angry that we named it, because it's no longer God. Because once we name it, we're saying, you're not God, I'm naming you, and we ask God for help. And then if it gets reduced some more with God's help, great. So what if I limp? At least I'm walking. You know, I'm not sitting in the corner sucking my thumb. I'm walking and I'm going to the store and I'm saying hello to people. So what? So all of these are fear-based. You know, when the familiarity of the illness wants to take on a life of its own, a little bit like an addiction. I can see why you made the connection. But the remedy is similar. You have to name it. And that takes half the power away. And then ask God for help. And then other people. So this remedy applies, you know, and we don't have to like, I think we shouldn't, you know, blame ourselves in a bad way, but the more we can name it, it's a victorious thing to do. I think the society's become more conducive to all kinds of addiction. Kids are getting sexualized earlier. I think that is so, you know, like that for me, this is mind-boggling to see how Madison Avenue, you know, whoever the marketers are out there, are targeting families and children at a younger and younger age so that they can have them as customers later on. As I tell my students, the Kool-Aid of the society, don't drink the Kool-Aid, it's poison. Just because it tastes good, it's poison. But we're used to the Kool-Aid. So we ask God for help. The more we ask God for help in a relaxed way, that reduces the Kool-Aid's power also.
Thank you, Presbyter.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
for all for coming. Let us finish with a prayer.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory now and forever into the ages of ages. Amen.
I also wanted to thank the sponsors today. Many is presenting the Philoptokos Ladies Society. They are sponsoring us to continue here. And Martin and Anthony are individuals who came forward and donated money so that we can continue this process. And of course, if we run out of money, the church has promised to help us a little bit. For next time, just spread the news, bring your friends, bring your cousins, relatives, nephews, nieces, whatever you have, so that it's, you know, we have these wonderful speakers that we don't feel like we're wasting their time, okay? We have a great group, but so that it grows and we can, you know, one day close the doors and say, this night is ours. Next topic is consumerism. That's a very modern topic. That's part of kind of continuation of addictions, because we can get, I can confess in front of you, when I was in a bad place in my life, when I got agitated, the best place to go was Best Buy. Just go. I wouldn't even buy things because I didn't have money. I would just look at things. I would love to see have that in my house. Yeah. All right, and then move to the next. But then I realized that was kind of sucking me in, and it wasn't. I couldn't compete with Apple. I couldn't compete with Samsung or whatever. So I gave up. And the next one. So that's Dr. Petitsis, that's December 15th. It's always the second Thursday of the month. That's Dr. Petitsis will be our guest. And then the next one will be on attachment theory. Dr. George Stavros will present. That's January, second Thursday of January. And I will prepare a little clip as I did with Dr. FitzGerald, and I send it to you so that you have approximate idea what is it going to touch upon.